Things change in 2022. So let's cover the top 10 tips and tricks that you can utilize in 2023 in the Hunter Call of the Wild to help you get more diamonds, more trophies, and have more luck in the new year. So shooting tips and tricks, we've got tip number one right here coming up. One that is just going to be a freebie that you may not know is we all know you have to know your yardage. And we see here this doe is about 153 meters. And that's because I have the binoculars that have the rangefinder equipped. But if you don't have that and you have the starting binoculars that don't have that and you don't have the rangefinder, when you open up your map, you're going to see here that you get the animal location pinged on your map. Down in the bottom right, we have the distance where your cursor is at. It should be the same way on console, just wherever your cursor or your display is hovering over. That's how far away it is from you. So if you hover over the animal location, you see we're at 153. That's a free tip, not included in the top 10 that I'm throwing at you. Now, this first tip is shooting sway. A shooting sway can be quite a pain in the butt if you're fighting it a lot. You're holding your breath, you're fighting it, you're really fighting that sway that's there. There's actually a pattern to it, and it's kind of like, think of the character breathing up or breathing in. That's when it's going up. Breathing down, breathing out, it goes down, and it's going to the left. Sometimes it goes to the right. It changes as you go. So when you hold your breath, it still is there, not as dramatic. Now, you can try and fight it, which you'll see I do a lot. I just fight it and place it where I want it because 308 is so powerful. I know it's not too big of a deal. If I'm going for a heart shot, I'll slow it down and I'll let it go up. And right when it's about to drop is when I'll shoot because I'll place it where I want it to go. So we know it's going up and to the left. I'll bring it over, let it come up. And of course, now it's going to go to the right, but let it come up and it starts to drop. Then I'll shoot. Now we'll shoot this girl and we'll go into tip number two, which is shot placement, which is easier to talk about if we go into the harvest screen. You just saw I let that go up and then right before it dropped down, I took the shot at that peak of that inhale. Right when he inhales, at that peak of that inhale is right when he starts to exhale and the gun starts to drop. That's when you want to take the shot. Easiest way to do it. You're not fighting that rifle sway, which is a little too dramatic in the game, but best way to handle it. When you're going for shot placement, it's pretty common knowledge on where you want to aim. Before we go into the x-ray view, we'll just kind of show it. If the animal is profiled to you like this, just standing sideways, perfectly straight sideways at you like she was, best place to aim is the crease right there of the armpit. So you're guaranteed to hit double lung with that if you're using a strong enough caliber to get through all the way to double lung. That's where you're guaranteed. Same if it's quarter and away, you're going to aim quarter away. It means it's looking about quarter turn away from you. You're going to place it right in that crook of the armpit. Now, if you're wanting to go for a heart shot and it's quartered hard away, right down near the elbow, right in that crease, you want to aim there. If it's quartering to you though, is when it starts to change. You're going to come forward. You're going to aim right in that front shoulder there. You're going to hopefully miss the shoulder and the scapula, which is running like right there. And you're going to get into that lung, possibly a double lung. Quartering away, we talked about that. Straight on or straight profile, easy. Rear shots, you'll hear the Texas heart shot. We're not going to go into that one because that's a dumb shot to take, most likely. You're not going to get all the way into a vital anyways with most of the guns here when you're shooting big game like this. So don't go for the Texas heart shot unless you're just playing around. And then the other one to go for is the frontal shot. Frontal shot in real life is highly debated as whether or not it's ethical. And I'm not even sure why we're in this screen. We can go here. The frontal shot means the animal is straight on to you. You'll see me do it if it's slightly turned. Straight on is the easiest way to do it. And on this, you are going for the heart. You're not going for anything else because you can split the lungs. If you're too high, split the lungs. If you're too low, you won't hit anything. But you want it basically when you're looking at them right where that neck meets the chest. That's where the heart's at, right there. And this is really easy to learn once you get one down. You can kind of study the anatomy by going into the x-ray view. So you can see here we were aiming right there, crook of the elbow or crease of the armpit. And we got perfect double lung. You can go for a heart shot with the 308 when they're like this as well, because they'll punch through that shoulder. Guns like the 243, definitely the 223, are not going to be going through that shoulder. So it really depends on what you're shooting, the animal, the caliber you're using, whether or not you want to go for a heart shot when it's perfectly perpendicular sideways to you. And then if it's quartering away from you, you can see where that heart is. Then you go here, aiming right there at the crook of that elbow. It's a hard quarter away, like I said. You're going to want to be right around in that elbow area, and that's going to get you a perfect heart shot. Quartering to you, like I said, kind of aiming right at that front shoulder. You're going to be up high if you're going for a double lung. If you want to go for the heart shot, coming down, kind of where that crease is there, that'll get you that heart shot. But that frontal shot is the key. Easiest way to get that insta drop on these animals is the heart shot, especially when it's straight on at you. Just like that. You see where you want to aim. Right there where the neck kind of meets the chest there. The brisket coming in and everything. You want to be right there. Same with real life. Like I said, it's kind of a debated hot topic of whether or not that's an ethical shot. Gets them down quick though, especially if you get that heart. I mean, they won't go far at all in the game. They instant drop. And it's a great shot to take. And now let's move on to tip number three, map knowledge. Map knowledge is going to help you out a lot when you're playing the game. You'll get to know the hot spots. You'll get to know where the best places are to fast travel. So we're on Leighton Lakes, and this is an easy one to go to talk kind of map knowledge, because one of our recent videos we did was looking at Roosevelt and Blacktail, and because I knew the hot spots, we were able to drop diamonds. When I do a how-to video on how to get diamonds and rares, we'll dive more into this and how to get those. But let's talk map knowledge just briefly, looking at this map, and we're talking Leighton Lakes. So if you're going for whitetail, which a lot of people are doing on Leighton, you're going to want everything to the left of my cursor, and basically, so this whole river unit on the left side, all the lakes on the left side of the map, coming down, not this lake in the center. I've never found whitetail there. And then all the way over this way, and then down, and all the way around. Whole southern coastline down here, kind of center of the map and over. And then the river system here, just in the center of the map, not going up. They kind of stop right there. You can get them here. I don't have them there. Some people do. My buddy's map has them there. And then all of Belmont Center gets whitetail. That's a good way to know where to go. Hot spots for them would be all along the river. I really like here. There's a hidden lake that's right here on the map. That's a good spot to go. Really good spot is here as well. Every map's a little different. The hot spots usually stay the same. The need zones are different on every map. Like I said, you can have some here. You cannot have them. Like with the blacktail. The blacktail were pretty unique. I repeatedly had good zones right here on the southern end of this lake, just east of Sheila Outpost. I repeatedly had good zones when I was playing on multiplayer maps for blacktail there. Roosevelt are the same way. Repeatedly good zones there. Good zones up here. Blacktail and Roosevelt were good there. These were all hot spots. And then we found that diamond up here along the riverside on the east side of it. We found that diamond Roosevelt up there. So this was a good spot as well. I had a couple big fours here on my map. Had some here at this lake. When you know the hot spots and you know the map, you know where the fast travel to and how to run to those. So when I would start out on a multiplayer map and I was going for Roosevelt or Blacktail, I'd start here at Norden Outpost. I'd hit this lake because I could find Blacktail and Roosevelt there. Then I'd run north to this way because of how the wind works. Then I could see this whole entire lake. There was never nothing here. Sometimes zones there, but usually I could just full on sprint to there and then check the whole lake. Then I could full on sprint to this little hunting stand here, and then I could check both these lakes. And that was the routine I'd do. And I'd check multiple maps that way. And then I'd hit down here to at least this lake. Sometimes I'd come down to here to the Chila Southern Outpost, and I'd run to the west there and check that lake, just depending on my mood. And I didn't check the river system until I got on my map, because I had more time on my map to play around. Map knowledge is key, though, if you're wanting to get diamonds and have better luck at finding rares and diamonds and seeing more animals. Tip number three, skills and perks. Everyone's a little different on this. You get skills and perks as you level up. If you're not fully leveled up, you're not going to be able to take advantage of all the skills and perks that you can get. You can't have them all, so you got to be selective as you're going through. Be smart on your selection. Know where you want to go. So you really want to look through it all. But if you come into the menu, you have perks and skills. Look through them all. You have the stalker, the ambusher, and the skills. And then you have perks, which is rifles, handguns, shotguns, archery. Know what you're going to be using the most. I use rifles a lot. I use shotguns a lot. And I use handguns a lot. I'm not real big into the archery. I love using archery, but I didn't need to go that far to need all of these. I don't use it that often. When I do, I don't need these perks. So we just didn't go with it. And then the rifle and handguns, like I said, everyone's a little different. Really big one to get is the zeroing, all the way up to the long range zero. So you want to work your way to them. You unlock them as you spend perk points. So you have to plan it out. That's why I have two in archery, so that I could get more spent that would unlock. Because as you spend it, it unlocks other perks. But this is a big one to get. The reload, muscle memory is a good one to get. I mean, you kind of have to get that one anyways when you start spending. The decrossed wobble we talked about, that helps with your sway, that breathing up and down. You have a lot of it if you don't have these perks. So level that one all the way up. Hold breath. That one helps a lot because you guys know if you're running and you're out of breath, the sway is even worse. This just helps it a little bit. And same with if you're holding it and you run out of breath, it helps out quite a bit. Now onto the skills. There's this one really comes down to personal preference on certain stuff. Further decreases your visibility in large bushes. That's a good one to get. The disturbed veg, you really want to work towards this one if you're wanting to find rares, because you'll see the disturbed vegetation and it'll tell you the fur type of the animal. But there's a lot in here. You kind of want to go through it. Endurance is a good one to have. Everything that decreases your visibility and sound are good to have. Same with tracking. Tracking's a good one to get. You go into ambusher. I mean, I didn't really care for this one, but you had to spend 2 points to unlock the next row and get more money. If you're trying to find money, this is a good one to have. Pack mules, like the one that I said earlier, is a really good one to have. I don't have it anymore because I wanted that disturbed vegetation. I had to pick or choose. So disturbed veg is definitely one I took. The reveal of information is really good to have. I highly suggest getting all three of these so you can see the estimated weight. You can see the health of the animal and how the animal's attitude is. Really good perks to have. Go through them, see which ones you like, see which ones you want to work towards. You can always reset them. It costs a lot of money to do it. I had to do it when they fixed it and we had to get the disturbed vegetation. I had to do it and it sucked and took a lot of my money, but you got to do what you got to do to have the perks you want. Tip number five, species knowledge. This is really important. You want to know need zones, trophy scores, fur types. Those are things that you want to know so you know what kind of trophies you're looking for or where to go when you're hunting a specific species. You'll see I hunt a lot of drink time because that's the easiest place to go to find the animals is when they're drinking. So I'm here on steamcommunity.com. I'll link this in the description below. This was made by a member of the community and he's a pretty up to date, he or she. I'm sorry, but Tilta. It looks like a male. Hard to tell, but either way, he keeps this pretty up to date and you can see it's updated as of December 2022. So all the need zones are up to date with everything that's changed coming around on the Reventuli release. But you can go through here, you can see Layton Lakes, Hirschfeld, and Medved, all the maps. You can go to everyone, including New England Mountains. And this gives you a good idea of where everything's drinking or what time everything drinks at. So bobcat 3 to 6. Some of them don't drink, so that's not applicable, but you can see when they feed, when they rest, gray fox, 1700 to 2000. Same with red fox, moose, 1200 to 1600. All this really good knowledge to have, so you know where to go at on the map when you go into the map and you want to hunt specific species. Say you go on to Mississippi Acres, you want to hunt black bear. You want to set the time to, I usually go 30 minutes after the start time because these are rounded. So there are different zones. Some start at 2000, some start at 2030. Just kind of depends. So I always start 30 minutes to 40 minutes after their drink time starts. That way they're already at their zones. You don't have to worry about chasing around. The other one to go to is the trophy ratings and fur types. Again, linked below. Now this is really good. This is my cheat sheet. I usually have this opened up so that I can see, all right, I'm going for, let's go down to Hirschfelden because I never go there. And I'm going for the Euro bison. And I pick up a weight track. I want to know that's a max weight track. So we're going to be like, okay, it's 920 kilos. Now I know I'm tracking something that's max weight, which means it could be a max level, which it also has at level 5. And also, when you have the right perks, like we talked about in the last tip, you can see its rating potential and it gives you the range. So you know, oh, hey, this is actually a level 4, but it's diamond potential because its estimate goes to 281 or whatever. So you know it's diamond potential, something worth taking down, or you can leave it and let someone else take it if it's not diamond potential and you don't care. Also has the information for the great ones and which maps they're on. The other important thing that it has is the rare career variations. This is awesome to have. And it's just because there's some maps like here, we have the Euro rabbit. Melanistic is uncommon on Hirschfelden. I mean, all the maps with the Euro rabbits. The melanistic is uncommon, which means if you shoot one, it's not actually a rare. The only rares are the albino and leucistic. You see the Canada goose, you have the bald leucistic, light gray leucistic, and the melanistic. Those are very rare. They're a lot less common to get versus like just a normal rare. It's still rare and hard to find, but it's a little bit more common than the very rare. There's the mission ones you can get, like the albino fallow deer on Hirschfelden, part of the missions. And then, of course, you have the great ones, which have the fabled spotted fur type. Or if you go to Layton, you have the great one black bear and the great one moose. And the black bear, actually, they don't say it on here, but black bear and moose, they all have the different fur variations that you can get. So very important to know these if you're going after trophies. Check the links down below. Support these people who make this one. This is a different one, Jody, making this one. So support these people. Go to the Steam community website. Keep them open when you're hunting. You'll know what you're going for as far as trophies go. Tip number 6. And this is something that I'll dive way more into detail if you guys want. Yeah, because it's part of how to get more rares and more diamonds. A lot of people have already covered it as well. But if you guys want an updated video that is more geared to 2023 and all the new maps, let me know and we'll dive into it. But this is multiplayer hopping. What is multiplayer hopping? Well, you go into the multiplayer, you pick a map you want to go to. Let's say I want to go Yukon Valley and I want to hunt moose. So I'm going to look for a time where moose are drinking. I believe they're 1200. I closed out the screen from the last one. They should be about 1200 to 1400. There's one, 1203. Not a great one to jump into, has 7 to 8 people. So not great. Let's see if there's one a little bit later. 1400, that's pretty good. 2 to 4, still not great, but it's only 4 and there's only 2 people in there. So that would be one to check. There's 1300 with 2 to 3. You kind of want ones like this one, 1 to 8. But this one only is a little bit before moose drink time at 1138. So you can get in there and kind of run around, wait until moose start drinking, which isn't a bad option. Here's one just about at the end of moose drink time, 1 to 7. Another one, good one to get into, except for moose are done drinking by this point. 1311, 2 to 5. That's actually a good one to get into. So we'll jump into this one. When you get in, there's a couple things you want to look at. We'll cover that as soon as it loads in, or you'll get a server disconnection before you even get in. So we'll go back into Yukon and let's find one. Let's just go this one. 7 of 8 people. They said not a great one to go into because it's 7 of 8. So I'm going to be the last one coming in. Then it's a full lobby. It's a lot harder to run around the map and be by yourself when there's eight people in the map. It means there's also a lot of competition. When you get in, first thing to check is this. You open this up. I'm not sure how to do it on console. On PC, I've got it as the I hotkey. So when I hold I, it comes up. I can also hold escape and it'll come up and not open up the map. That was a loud shot. Someone's close by. But we can see the host has the crown next to his name. And that is 17. That's really good. That means they're pretty new to the game. If they are the original host of this map, should mean it's a pretty fresh map. Since we're moose drink time, we want to know the moose hotspots like we talked about before. This does not look like a new map. If you see, he's got a lot of tents up already. There's a couple tents and blinds set up. So it looks like this might not be a new map. A bit of hunting pressure. But let's go down here. We're near here. He's got zones there, but not for moose. This is a really good hotspot for moose. He's got no zones there. That's a spot I'd run to and check. I know that's a hotspot for moose. He has no zones. Great place to go. That means there's a good chance of a good-sized animal there. And here, it's been searched, but there's only one. There should be at least one more. Usually there's one more. But you're looking to see how many zones they have. And zones for the animal you're hunting. You're looking at the hotspots for these animals. You see there's some there. There's some here. So this map's been hunted quite a bit. But there's quite a few zones that aren't found yet for moose. Checking all the areas that I know of for hotspots for moose. And there's quite a few. Like these lakes here. It looks like they haven't found anything. This guy's headed this direction, and there has been some zones found there. But let's go up here, and we'll just check. We'll check it out, see if we have anything good up here. Now, the key to multiplayer hopping as I run up to these two lakes is you don't want to spend too much time in it. If you're in there, and you're not seeing anything good, the activity's too high, you notice there's a hacker in the lobby, get out, move on to something else. We see here we have one max level person in here besides myself, and it doesn't guarantee that there's not a hacker in the lobby, but that's a good way to check as well. Best, easiest way to see if someone's hacking is sometimes they'll have it to where their level just keeps going. You cap out at 60. The game stops you at 60. So if someone's at a 61 level or higher, they're a hacker. It's just a guaranteed way to tell someone's hacking. Another way to check is watch them move around. If they're moving really fast, they've got speed hacks. And I'll usually back out. I won't spend a lot of time in the map because I just can't guarantee that the map is legit at that point, so I'll leave the map because I don't want to be in a hacked lobby and my trophy come from one. It's just not worth it. It ruins the trophy if it's hacked. But usually I'll run around, check a few of the hotspots. If I'm not seeing anything good right away, I'll leave and I'll go to a different map. That's what multiplayer hopping is all about. A lot of people get stuck into, well, this is a fresh map, and they'll stay on it. I do it too. I get stuck on it. I'll be running around and it's a fresh map. It's a low level host. I'm like, man, this map's got to be good, and I'm not finding anything good. And I'll spend an hour to 2 hours on that map and never find a trophy. And when I should have left after the first 30 minutes, because I knew nothing good was there, because I just wasn't seeing any high level animals. So you don't want to get sucked into being on one map when you're multiplayer hopping for too long. Hunt the map for a little bit. You're not seeing anything good. Peace out. Find a different map to get into. And that's how I find diamonds and trophies, is multiplayer hopping. Like I said, I'll cover it more in depth in a video if you guys like, on how to do it. Show exactly how I do it. Keep the video less edited so you all can see how that works. But let's check this map, these two lakes out real quick. See if we find anything good. Tip number 7, grinding and herd management. Now, why is this a tip or trick? This is a good trick to spawn a lot of diamonds of a certain species, or to get a diamond of a certain species if you haven't gotten it yet and you really want it. Set up a grind for them. We're on Teowara, and we'll just briefly talk about how to grind for level 9 red deer. That's a guaranteed troll. He's on the map. I'm leaving him there because that's part of stacking, which is part of the herd management. Now, when you start on a grind, you want to find all your zones for the animals. So that's, again, where your map knowledge comes in. Find all your zones, get a buddy to help you run around, find all your zones, and then start setting up tents and tripods. And when you're grinding, if you're just grinding, you're just going to be shooting every animal you see. You're not going to worry too much about level, weight, anything like that. And that's actually my first time seeing a mallet on Teowara. That's pretty neat. But yeah, you're not focused on any of that. You're just killing all the males when you're grinding. That's how you're going to get yourself some diamonds and whatnot, or a great one. Now, if you want to go into herd management, it's a little bit more technical. We've covered it before on the channel, but basically you're going to leave lower level animals, so it force spawns higher level animals on your map. That's the TLDR of herd management. If you want more on it, I have channels in the video. Scarecrow goes into depth on it. Kill Clinton goes into depth on it. Check their videos out as well, and you can see a real depth tutorial on herd management. Now let's get on to tip number 8. Tip number 8. We'll stay here on Teowara. We'll use these guys as my test subjects, I guess. So spook radius. Well, actually, we have some red deer here too. Spook radius. Knowing spook radius is huge, especially when you're just running around, running and gunning. If we look here, we've got that at 190 meters. I'm not going to spook it no matter what I do as far as movement goes. But we'll see. Those guys are alert. They're actually alert because of my scent. So this is not the best example. But using those, we'll use this Troll 9 as an example. He might smell me, he might not. But running, I can run all the way up to 150 meters. 150. Now, they're a little bit more sensitive now since the most recent update, but 150 meters is safe. I usually stop at about 160 just to be 100% sure, but they're already alert because of my scent. But yeah, so you run all the way up to that, and then you can slow down to a walk to probably 120 to be safe. I do 100 sometimes, and it works out fine. Then you want to go down to a crouch, and then you want to go down to a crawl. And those meters, I'm not quite sure where they're at now because I haven't had to get in that close. Usually I get into about 150 and then I take them down. The other spook radius thing, and the one that changed everything with the update, is shot radius spook. Used to be able to, and that's why I haven't been on this grind recently, because I need to change everything up. Used to be able to shoot with animals at 250 and they wouldn't spook. 250 meters, animals wouldn't spook from a gunshot. Now, they spook a lot close or a lot further away. So, let's back up from those guys and see if we can do this right. All right, we're about 300 away, and our guy is right there. Now, if we shoot off over that way and look at him, nothing changed. Nothing changed at all. All of them are still calm. Let's get a little bit closer. Should be at about 280, but it seems like that might not be the case. Let's see here. We're about 290 here. It's a little bit harder to get a good look at him from 280, but he should be still totally calm. Yeah, still totally calm. He's at about 290. But if we get up closer to about 250 and shoot, you guys will see he goes and flees. Now, I used to be able to shoot from 250. And not spook them off. And that's why the grinds are a little bit harder now, because when you're at 250 and you shoot, you'll spook off the rest of the herds around, and it's just not any fun. But we can't even get 250. I was going to do a 250 meter show of it, but if we go here, you see that changed really quick to alarmed and then fleeing. And that just makes grinding a little bit harder, or shooting around lakes, because most of the lakes aren't that big that you're going to be hunting on. And that's just the nature of the beast. The spook radius is bigger now for about everything. Even running, they spook sooner at 150 when you're running like this. They're usually alert when I hit that 150 meter. So that's why I said about 160, I'll slow it down to a walk. And then we'll drop it down to a crouch at about 100. Or 120, just kind of depends on the animal I'm going for. Yep, that's spook radius. Let's move on to tip number 9. Tip number 9, top 3 maps, including the DLCs. We're going to start out with my number 1, and I believe pretty much everyone's number 1 for diamonds. That's Silver Ridge Peaks. Silver Ridge Peaks is one of the easiest maps to get diamonds on. the lakes don't have a lot of vegetation around to make it hard to see, like Layton Lakes. Layton has a lot of tall reeds that hide the deer or the moose or the elk. Makes it a little harder to hunt, but Silver Ridge Peaks, if you're wanting diamonds and you're starting out, that's the map to go to. Map number two would be Virhunga Savannah. I don't hunt this map as much as I should for it being number two. This map's just a lot of fun because it has a lot of species, basically everything on it, except for now the teal. The teal's on Reventuli, but all the other species like the lion, the kudu, the Cape buffalo, the warthog, the springbuck, everything on this map is unique to Virhunga Savannah, and that's what makes it number two on my list. It's a little hard to hunt sometimes because of the vegetation around the lakes, but as a top three, it has to take number two. It kind of is tied for number one, but Silver Ridge Peaks is close to home because it's like my home. It's where I hunt in real life, so I like it. So Virhunga takes number two. And then number three would have to be Yukon Valley. Yukon Valley is so much fun to hunt. Good animal species. The lakes are laid out well. The map is cool. I love Alaska. I love the Yukon. By far, this is map number three on my list, personally. You guys leave a comment down below. What are your top three maps? Let's see if they line up with mine. You'd take these three I had, but just rearrange them. Or do you have all completely different maps as your top three? Now, last but not least, tip number 10. Tip number 10 is going to be about DLCs, the top three DLCs you can get, not including reserves, because we already talked about that. So hunting equipment, not Trophy Lodge, and not the dog. Of course, not cosmetics either. So lodges, let's just talk lodge, though. Sasagi Safari, by far the best lodge. That's the best lodge. Take that lodge. Get that lodge first. Or you get this one, Spring Creek Manor. The platforms are better. There's a lot more trophies you can put in there. Do that. Dog, pretty cool to have. But let's focus on which of these is some of the best to have. Number one of the three to get, probably going to be Weapon Pack 1. Weapon Pack 1, let's come down here and you can see why. The 22LR. If you don't have the 22LR, you need the 22LR. It's great for hunting things like ducks, turkeys, birds, all the small game, the rabbits, everything like that. The 22LR is so much better to use than the shotgun. You definitely want to get that. And you also get the crossbow with it, which is pretty good and powerful to take. Get some of the recurves as well. I think it's number one. You have to get that just for the 22LR. Then number two on my list would honestly probably be the Modern Rifle Pack. I think some people would disagree with me, but just for the 308, the AR-308. The AR-223 sucks. The AR-22 is what it is. The 223 altogether in the game sucks. It's a terrible caliber, terrible penetration. I'm hoping they fix it. I know Hunter DD is trying to get it taken care of. He's in talks with Expansive Worlds. I would love to get in talk with them as well. The calibers in the game could use all the buff or adjusting all around. All the calibers could use it, but especially the 223. The 223 could use so much love, and I hope they fix it. But if you're going to get Modern Weapon Pack, I think it's a necessary one to get because of the 308. You're grinding things like Red Deer, White Tail, Ibex, all those animals. The 308 is just, it's the gun to have. It is by far the gun to have. So you need the Modern Weapon Pack. And last but not least, it's kind of a toss-up. And I'm going to put three into the final third top three, because they kind of all go together. That's Tents and Ground Blinds, Wild Goose Chase, and Duck and Cover Pack. These three together work really well when you're hunting ducks. And ducks, like we know, especially goose, are some of the best ways to make money. You can set up a tripod, have a tent there on Hirschfelden in one of the fields, call the geese in, and just go to town making money. You can make a lot of money really fast by hunting geese.
Same with the ducks. If you want to hunt ducks on Reventuli, you need the water blind or blind of some sort. You need the decoys. You need the collars. So I really do recommend all three of these as being the top three DLC pack. Not top three, but the third placement, because they all go together as far as DLCs. The other ones you can all kind of do without, but I guess you could get the tree stand and the tripod pack for the ducks, but you can do it with the ground blinds. But yeah, those are top three. So number one, weapon pack one, number two, modern rifle pack, and the number three is tree tents and ground blinds with the wild goose chase gear and the duck cover pack. Those are the top three DLCs to get, in my opinion. And with that, guys, I'm going to wrap it up. That is my top 10 tips and tricks for the Hunter Call of the Wild in 2023. A lot of these apply to all the years, but in 2022, they changed that spook radius. So I wanted an updated one on YouTube for you guys out there so you guys can see what I believe are the top 10 tips and tricks. Do you have any more you want to suggest? Leave a comment down below. If it's one of the best ones, I'll pin it and you'll have your comment pinned. And everyone can argue and fight with you that your tip and trick is terrible, like you all are going to do with me. Just kidding. You guys are awesome. You guys are always showing support for me and the channel, and I love it. If you're new to the channel and you haven't yet, please consider hitting the subscribe button and the bell notification. Make sure you turn on all notifications and have them turned on your device. That's how you actually get notified that new episodes have dropped. We drop them every Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday. And if you want to support the channel, we have memberships now. We have Patreon, and we have merch. Check it all out. Everything's linked down below in the description. And until next time, go enjoy your good hunt with a good friend. I'll catch you in the next one.